Any order is fine. Well, good morning, everyone. It is such a pleasure to be here with you today to speak to the how and why services industries are boosting productivity and innovation across the economy in the United States, in Europe, and around the world in this incredible marriage between the services industries and manufacturing and ag industries as a way to build growth. We have four fantastic panelists with you today. We're gonna ask each of them to give some opening remarks. We'll have some discussion, and then we'll open it up at the end for some questions from the audience. But before I turn it over to the panelists, if I can, I'd like to set the scene a little bit. We are just at the beginning of a new industrial revolution powered by the internet. Services based on cloud computing, big data, artificial intelligence, and the Internet of Things are transforming the ways manufacturers, farmers, and ranchers work and the value proposition that they're able to bring to their customers. Just to give one example, we can point to the issue of predictive analytics, where manufacturers are using cloud computing services, big data, and the Internet of Things to fix it before it breaks. Take the aircraft engine manufacturing industry, for example. An engine 15 years ago had very few sensors and generated a very small amount of signals and data. Today, each engine has many sensors and generates thousands of signals with a corresponding increase in the amount of data that's collected. One of our customers, a leading manufacturer of aircraft engines, is taking advantage of Microsoft's cloud and data analytics services to examine and analyze massive amounts of engine performance data in order to spot and address potential maintenance problems before they occur. These analytics services will also help the engine manufacturer advise customers on how to optimize conditions that promote fuel efficiency, such as flight plans, maintenance schedules, and how to navigate various weather conditions. The services revolution here is thus twofold. It's upstream in terms of transforming what the manufacturer can learn from the data its products are generating to produce better products, and it's downstream in terms of the valuable services it's able to provide and to sell to its customers. This is just one of literally thousands or tens of thousands of instances where services are coming together with manufacturing and the ag industry to generate innovation and growth around the world. So with that scene setting, then I'd like to first turn it over to Commissioner Broadbent. Then we're gonna ask Pascal to give some remarks, followed by Tom and then Sarah. So Commissioner Broadbent, please.
Thanks, Tom. Good morning, thanks for the opportunity to be here to speak about the contribution of services to manufacturing and agriculture. I wanna congratulate Christine on a great conference. I mean, we miss Peter, but we would never have booked near such good shopping in the Center Shopping District here in DC. So we welcome you all from out of town and take advantage of a lot of the nice places to visit in the area. I'm one of four commissioners at the U.S. International Trade Commission. I need to provide my normal disclaimer that I only speak for myself and don't reflect the opinions of others at the commission. The ITC does quite a bit of research in the services area. Two reports I'd like to highlight for you are a 2013 report entitled Services Contribution to Manufacturing and a report released just last month on digital trade. The recent report, this recent report describes the various trade barriers to digital trade, such as data localization requirements, and their impact on digital trade and the newest technologies and services, such as the Internet of Things, big data, artificial intelligence, and cloud computing. With the help and support of many of you in this room, our services division continues to focus on the interconnections between goods and services trade and how that relationship is changing over time. A key issue for us is how the servicification of goods trade, and I tried to pronounce that word and I can't practice it, but the servicification of goods trade and agriculture trade affects overall productivity in the United States and the global competitiveness of U.S. firms. The more surveys we can get your companies to fill out, and the more insights we can develop on trends. and I know how fun it is to get busy managers in your companies to fill out the surveys, so we do really appreciate your contributions to our work. We know that traditional services functions have always been part of manufacturing company business processes. These include R&D labs, accounting, finance, legal, sales, and distribution. For U.S. manufacturers, the contribution of services varies by sector from about 25 to 50%. At least some services are needed at almost every stage in the manufacturing value chain. The ITC found that there has been three drivers of manufacturers' use of services, which have reinforced and even expanded the use of certain services in the modern economy. The first of these key drivers is the increasing geographic dispersion of supply chains and specialization. Global supply chain management has led to increased use of services in communications, express shipment, customs, and logistics. The second key driver is the need to cut costs and improve efficiency, the drive to be ever more competitive in the global market. Information and communication services, including the internet, are perhaps the most critical contributor to improving efficiency. To be successful, companies must now use more sophisticated tools, including software services such as enterprise resource planning, business information systems to manage suppliers, track parts and inventory, reduce energy costs and other production costs, to enter and track orders and coordinate sales. The third key driver we found is the desire to enhance and deepen customer relationships by providing services related to their products. Many firms that once saw services as merely part of operating costs now highlight them as essential for providing a premium product, customizing and personalizing the product, and building brand loyalty and product dependence. As part of our 2013 report, we zeroed in on a subset of services, business services, which consist of information services, financial services, and professional services. And a couple of patterns emerged. There's been increasing use of these business services in manufacturing terms, both in the value of inputs, importantly, in the employment of services workers. We're seeing a lot more services workers working under the rubric of a manufacturing firm, and I think we need to look deeper into those numbers. And further, our study shows that these services enhance productivity, making companies more productive. Finally, one interesting conclusion on our study was that the computer and electronics product sector uses business services the most intensively, both purchased and in-house services, and that sector has shown the greatest productivity gains. We believe that this suggests that the use of digital technologies and related services by other manufacturing sectors beyond computer and electronics will lead to similar economy-wide benefits. I wanted just to spend a couple of minutes highlighting a few findings of our study relating to the most significant recent developments in the technologies of digital trade. These recent developments have been significant as to be characterized as transformative of the global economy, and as Tom mentioned, really leading to what I think the World Economic Forum has called the fourth industrial revolution. I wanted to make sure that we talked a little bit about agriculture, precision agriculture, which could also be called digital site-specific crop management, involves measuring the relevant conditions within each part of a field and determining the most effective treatments for that specific segment, and then applying the treatments as precisely as possible. Precision agriculture requires a wide variety of services. Location services like GPS allow a farmer to more precisely measure the characteristics of farmland. Rather than the average moisture content or the average pH of a field, a farmer can determine the growing conditions in each very small portion of the field. Given this data, a treatment or prescription can be determined for each small portion in the field, and through variable rate application inputs, the optimum treatment is applied. At harvest, yield data are also collected at a disaggregated level. This detailed information is available to farm managers making decisions on which crops to plant or how much fertilizer or pesticides to apply next year. Often, farm-specific data are combined with data on weather patterns, pest and disease infestations, global market conditions, exchange rates, and costs, and the expected response of possible interventions, such as applying a different type of fertilizer. This allows farmers to make better decisions and to make them on a more disaggregated, pinpointed basis, reportedly using farm field grids as small as almost 10 meters square. And we may have time to talk about this in later parts of the panel, but I did want to mention what we are seeing in data analytics as it's applied to the pharma and the chemical product development. Data analytics offers new approaches to product development, particularly pharmaceutical and chemical products, and we hope to learn more about this and potentially discuss it later in the panel. But these de novo design techniques use complex data sets to first model the physical setting and desired effect of a compound and then design a chemical using algorithms that will match the requirements. Because of the dramatic advances in digital technologies, the services sector is taking a larger role across major sectors of the U.S. economy, including manufacturing and agriculture. I look forward to hearing from my fellow panelists, and we'll be happy to take your questions at the end.
Thank you, Pascal.
Thank you. Thank you to the Global Services Summit and the CSI and Christine for the invitation. It's an honor to be here. I want to talk about what we call the servicification, but maybe we should talk actually about manufacturization of the services instead of the other way around. That would maybe drive more attention from the manufacturing sectors. But indeed, all those manufacturing and farming sectors, mining and quarrying, all of those are actually using and buying and providing a lot of services. And I think it's just good to remind that the National Board of Trade in Sweden actually tried to really analyze services by services sectors, what are the manufacturing sectors doing and buying. So to make a company efficient, there is a lot of embodied services, like the legal services, accounting services, financial services, that they are not actually providing themselves, but that makes a company much more competitive. And that's part of the whole package. And then you have the services which are embedded, that they are actually selling as a package. So you buy a train, or you buy a plane, or you buy a machine, and into these machines you have a lot of services which are management consulting, which are leasing, warehousing, and logistics, and all of these services. Now they really understand that it is part of their revenues, and I think that is important. And we have some figures in trade and services, but we're not really well served by the statistics institutes. And in the EU, for instance, we know that of all the export, it used to be a third travel, a third transport, and then a third other business, all the services. Now we have it a bit more fine-tuned, but nevertheless, still we have 27.5% which are other business services. So there is a huge part which is not well known, and I think we would be really have to call for more collection of statistics on services. If you look at the old way of counting international trade, so through the balance of payment, in the EU and the US it's nearly exactly the same. 31% of all our exports are services, which means that 68 are goods. That is a bit more than in the average worldwide, it's about 20-80. So goods is overwhelming in part, and therefore, you know, services, what are you talking about? You know, it is not something we should focus on because 80% is more in goods. Well, now we have a better way of counting, and thanks to ZWTO and the OECD, we have a new database, well, not that new anymore, but we start to spread the news, which is called TIVA, Trade in Value Added, and there we know now that for the EU and for the United States, it's more than 30% of the value of the export of goods. So forget about export of services. Export of goods, the value of the goods which are exported For the EU, 39%, and for the United States, 32% of all the value of these goods are actually services around the products. So we now have the possibility to show to the manufacturers that they have interest to look at this part of also of the of what is important for them. And if we top out the value of the services into the goods plus the pure export of services, we know now that the EU is 58% of total export is services, and for the United States it's 55%. And that is now really saying that it is not anymore a world of goods, but actually a world of services that we're living in terms of export. With these figures now, we know that we have to take more of the attention of the negotiators to tell them, please take more consideration in the trade policy about services negotiations. And this is where I wanted to come for a while, saying that negotiators need more to focus on trade and services during the negotiation of trade agreements. And you know, at the last minute, it's always meat and dairy and the manufacturing part, the tariff of the cars, etc. But now we know that actually nearly 60% of all the export of developed countries are about services, and therefore they really have to put more attention on this. You know, in the services world, we negotiate through modes of supply. And when I talk to my colleagues in the manufacturing sectors dealing with trade policy, they are interested in looking at the reduction of tariff or rules of origin, of standards on certification, IPR, etc. They never look at the services part, where actually this is where the money for them is. And I think they should really come and join us to push for opening more the services negotiations. When we talk about cross-border trade in services, of course it is transport and of course it is air cargo, shipping, etc. But it is essentially about cross-border data flow. And what Meredith told us about digitalization of the economy, 3D printing, Internet of Things, artificial intelligence, machine-to-machines, whatever communication with these data for the manufacturing sectors, it is negotiated under the services part, under the cross-border trade in services. And I think they should look at it and come and join us to push for more opening in these mode one, and also in putting some text into cross-border trading services where we have so much difficulties in Europe to do so. When we look at about commercial presence abroad, it's called the mode four of the mode three of the GATS. This is foreign direct investment. This is where a manufacturing plant, if they want to open it up, if they don't look at the possibility that it is effectively open in a trade agreement. I always take the example of BMW willing to open up a plant in a country. They're probably going to be welcome by the country. They're probably going to get a tax deduction. They probably get even some subsidies to go into that state instead of the other one to attract them and create jobs into that part of the country. If they forget to look at actually it is not possible for them to open a network of distribution of cars without having a local partner, they lose a large part of the benefit into this one. So, you know, they really have an interest also to look at this part of the negotiation. And finally, when we negotiate movement of natural persons and business people, that it is not only the bankers and the lawyers and insurers and the people doing management consulting, but it is also the engineers for GE or Siemens, if they want to move. This is negotiated under the mode four negotiation in the services chapter. I never see them coming and pushing with us to open up this part of the market. So I think that is something that we have to look at. And I think I'm going to stop here for the moment. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Pascal. Tom?
Well, thank you very much. And good morning. I'm almost literally fresh off the plane from a three-year assignment in London, so I'm delighted to be back in Washington and to be on the panel today. So thank you very much for the invitation. Listening to the remarks of the previous two panelists, it just underscores the importance of digital services and data, in particular cross-border data flows, to commerce. And so I would echo the remarks that Pascal just made about the importance of focusing on digital services in connection with trade talks, because it's an important element that hopefully I'll identify some of the applications of that that we do, but it's important not to lose sight of that in negotiations. So we would certainly support that element as well. So I think all or most of you are familiar with Verizon as a wireless provider or a wired services like Fios, internet access service provider. But within the United States and outside the United States, we've actually been engaged in a lot of transformation in our company. We've been moving into new areas, particularly around IoT, around smart cities, and even into drones and aerial systems in an effort to try and diversify our portfolio of services. So as we look at the things that Verizon is investing in and where we're moving today with our business outside of our core network services business, it really is focused on a lot of the areas that we're talking about here today around Internet of Things in particular. So we are now one of the largest, if not the largest, fleet management telematics companies in the world. We have operations in multiple countries around the world in the telematics space. We are working on different pilots in the smart city space in, last count, 40 cities around the world. So we are engaging and kind of pushing out at all three levels of what we call our sort of three-tiered strategy at Verizon. The first tier is the one you probably are most familiar with, which is the network. We have terrific networks inside the United States. We're also one of the largest providers of backbone services, IP services, outside the United States globally. We build on that with what we call a platform. So the platform is, you typically think of as your IoT platform, the various layers of data analytics that ride the network, and on top of that you have the applications, the services that actually provide the information and analyze the data for the various types of businesses that we work with. So we, and then on top of all that, we recently acquired two companies that I'm sure most of you know, AOL and Yahoo. They provide a lot of data analytics services in addition to obviously advertising and that type of service. So as you can tell, Verizon is moving above the network to try and find new ways to invest, to generate revenues obviously, but also to move deeper and deeper into the digital services space. So I wanted to talk a little bit today about some of the things that we're doing and to build on the comments that have already been made. I'll start at the network level. Verizon has introduced a new technology that is called 4G LTE Cat M1. So that's an awful lot of acronyms, but it's essentially a new network technology that allows and enables Internet of Things and connectivity to the Internet of Things. So it's what, if you think about the three-tiered platform and three-tiered strategy I mentioned a few minutes ago, that's looking at the network level. On top of that, we've made investments in various platforms and applications. We have something called ThingSpace, which is a platform which allows developers to come in and to easily connect to the Internet of Things itself, to the network. It provides essentially a one-stop shop for anybody to come in and try and hook into the ecosystem, into the network. Then on top of that, we've got the applications. And this is where I think it's perhaps most interesting in terms of the discussion today. So let me quickly talk about three different industries where we're doing work today. The first is, I would call it sort of the transportation and pharmaceutical industry. We have services today that we offer that will allow for digital tracking and tracing of, for example, pharmaceutical shipments. There are laws out there now in the United States, and they're expanding into Europe. I think they go into effect next year, maybe in Europe, that require drug manufacturers to essentially know where their drugs are as they're being shipped. You can think of a lot of reasons why that would be important. But the services that we offer, in addition to that, can tell whether a shipment has not only gone to where it's supposed to go, but it can tell where it's going in the midst of that. We call it ring fencing. So if all of a sudden a truck departs from where it's supposed to go, an alarm can go off almost immediately, and then there can be a quick examination as to why that was. Was the truck is it breaking down? Was there a traffic rerouting problem? Or was there something more nefarious that's happening? The service also allows for tracking of moisture and heat, and whether or not a particular box or crate has tipped over, which can tell a lot of information. It can be very important to the manufacturer. If you have something that says must remain upright, it's good to know that it actually is. So that's just a simple application that we're working on and working with pharmaceutical companies to do. Agriculture. So we talked about agriculture earlier. It's very important to the Internet of Things. The opportunity is to go out and help with the pinpoint growth of crops, to know what the moisture content is of the soil, what the fertilizer content is, how are things working, the sunlight, all of that, and be able to do that in a very specific area, and to know whether it's different in particular plots within a farm, is something that we are able to help our customers do. We have a relationship with a winery called Hahn Wineries in California, and we are helping them with their agriculture, their viticulture, to understand the growth and how they're growing their wines, their vines. And so IoT can help at very targeted levels, and it can also help with larger farms. And pulling all that data and that information together is what is ultimately enabling the farmers to increase their own productivity. And that goes back to the cross-border data flow point that's been made already, and how important all of these things are, because they all generate data. And you have to be able to move that data from one place to another, and data doesn't always stay within a single country. So finding ways to limit the restrictions on cross-border data flows is very important. Dealing with issues like data localization, it's an important issue. Privacy, data localization drives certain behaviors, but can also interfere with the flow of commerce. So these are things that we at Verizon are particularly interested in addressing, and hope that any trade policy and trade discussions will also get into some of those areas as well. The third area of industry that I just wanted to briefly touch on was around drones. And so with drones, we've actually purchased a company that is engaged in that sells drones and ultimately manufactures them. We've got our LTE chips that we're installing in those, so that the drone can communicate obviously with the ground. And so those drones have multitude of different applications, both in the farming and the agriculture space. They can help with examining cell towers, cell phone towers. They can help with anything, just a wide variety of issues. So again, IoT is expanding the reach and the imagination. It's tapping into the innovation that's going on. And so from our perspective, on a US as well as an international perspective, what we need to do, importantly, is to avoid regulations that are going to interfere with that innovation. They're going to slow the investment. So regulation is appropriate in many instances, no question about it. But if you overregulate these nascent industries, you're simply going to slow them down, and you're also going to interfere with the development of those industries in different places. So we're hoping that as we kind of move forward with this, with a digital services discussion, that we can look at the level of regulation, decide what's appropriate, what's necessary, but what's not. Let's not overregulate, and let's try and do everything we can to continue to encourage the innovation that is going to help in the various sectors that we've just been talking about. I'll stop there, Tom. Thanks.
Thank you for having me on the panel today. Can anyone hear me? Okay. Before I begin and give you examples of what we're doing, I wanted to just clear the air that MasterCard is not a credit card company. We are a technology company. We process transactions. We connect to 22,000 financial institutions to 37 million merchants around the world in 210 countries. And we're really a network that utilizes data flows. So we actually don't hold any funds. We're really passing data back and forth across borders every single day. So Pascal's point about the free flow of data is so vitally important to our business. And market access to the 210 countries around the world is also very important to us. We also believe that IoT, Internet of Things, is really an important area, and that's what we're really heavily investing in as a company. We think, there's many figures out there, 30 billion, 50 billion devices by 2020, and we look at those devices that every device can be a commerce device. So that's how we're approaching it in terms of helping manufacturers kind of enhance the consumer experience, and I'll give you a few examples of those. But you might not always think about MasterCard and manufacturers, how does that really intersect? But one of our really great examples is we've been working with GM and their OnStar system. So OnStar is not a new technology, it's been out there for I think over a decade. But what we've done is we've enabled OnStar into our payment wallet. So now the 7 million vehicles that are connected to OnStar can use the OnStar system to pay for gasoline, find a parking spot, pay for coffee, and it's sort of enhancing that digital experience for the consumer. But also another example of kind of taking a step further and how digitally enabled services can actually help in disaster recovery or in hurricane situations. During the hurricanes in Texas and Florida, we actually used our transaction data through the OnStar system to locate where the gas stations that were actually open. And we used that information and we sent it to FEMA and emergency responders to let them know that these areas in Texas and these areas in Florida, that's where the gas stations were actually open, which was actually helping not only the emergency responders, but also consumers find gas in this situation. Another example that we like to use is the smart fridges. So Samsung has come out with these smart refrigerators that kind of give you a list of options to kind of fill your refrigerator, and you can put your shopping list. So we've connected with the Samsung fridge our payment functionality. So you can actually pay for your groceries through the app and get it delivered from FreshDirect or other participating suppliers. Another fun example I like to use is I'm looking at the crystal chandeliers here. We just had this partnership a couple weeks ago. We announced with Swarovski. And what we're doing is we're partnering with them using a virtual reality mask where you can actually visualize some of their home accents products into your own home. And through this app, whether you blink or you kind of twitch, you can actually purchase things. So it's a little dangerous, but it's just an example of how technology is really moving fast. And through these services, like payments and things like that, can actually enhance consumer experiences. I think I'll stop there for now.
That's great.
I don't want to take up too much time.
Thank you all for those remarks. I think it's a great scene setting for the ways in which services are really impacting manufacturing and agriculture, particularly digital services. And you've all raised the importance of cross-border data flows. Tom, you touched on a couple of the legal and regulatory issues that have an impact on cross-border data flows. Commissioner Broadbent, I know the ITC has done a lot of work in this area, so maybe if I could ask you to kick off a discussion about the kinds of barriers that we see around the world, and then ultimately the role that trade agreements can play in reducing those barriers, specifically with respect to trade and digital services.
Identified sort of the major barriers that companies were describing to us. And I'll just kind of run through them because it's a long list and it's a growing list. Data localization and data flows, including privacy protection, exaggerated cybersecurity protections, forced source code disclosure, IPR protections and adequate protection of copyright, leading to widespread piracy, censorship, blocking and filtering of specific content, market access barriers like low de minimis rules for customs clearance, restrictions on electronic payment systems, technical standards and hardware and software, especially in China. Excuse me. Government procurement rules giving preference to domestic firms. We found that a lot in India. Investment limitations on ownership, where you have a 45% ownership limitation, discriminatory licensing and taxation policies, and other local content requirements. Data localization loomed as the biggest concern if you had to look at our research. Data localization barriers worldwide have doubled in the last 6 years to the extent we could count them, from 40 to 80 instances that we were able to identify in 65 countries. And we looked at key markets, Brazil, China, the EU, India, Indonesia, and Russia, and we're having problems in all of those markets. And I think that it kind of dovetails with another finding in the study, which is that the U.S. Is really spent the most on public cloud computing of any country in the world. We spent $44 billion last year, and the EU spent $15 billion, and China $1.3 billion. And our major providers of Amazon, Microsoft, Google, and IBM are really the top global providers of cloud services and cloud computing services, which is is really undergirding the ability of manufacturing industries to analyze the data that they need and manipulate it in a way that's workable given the volume of data that the internet is giving us now. So a lot of just interesting trends out there, and would really recommend our study to you to get some further information.
Pascal, is the your different?
There is one word in Brussels which is dominating the debate, which is privacy. Data protection by some part of the regulators and by a lot of people in the civil society is a fundamental human right. And to go above fundamental human right, it's very complicated. So we have this so-called GDPR for General Data Protection Regulation, which is going to come into place on 28th of May next year, and which is putting obligations to companies who want to use data of European citizens outside the EU to have some requirements. Some of them are local data localization. We have tried to move this debate and tried to have some language into the EU trade agreement on cross-border data flow, including also in TISA, Trade in Services Agreement. And so far, we have failed. The thing is, there is so strong belief that we cannot move beyond this fundamental human right must be respected at any price, that when we try to push to say, okay, now that you have the GDPR, you have your protection, can we move on and put an exception to the rules, but at least we can move on so that our companies are not going to be faced by further data localization requirement like in China, in Russia, in Indonesia, in Vietnam, etc. But it is very complicated. And there is another element that it is difficult for us to measure, but what the top of the European Commission and two or three other countries, essentially France, Slovenia, and Greece, are blocking the debate, is about NGOs, anti-globalization NGOs, might pick up the subject of data protection being sacrificed under the hotel of big multinational companies. So therefore, they fear that these NGOs are going to use, like they did ISDS issue into TTIP and succeeded to stop TTIP. They might use data protection to stop any new trade agreement by the EU. So for the moment, they prefer to keep low profile and don't put that into the table. This is not the willingness of most of the political world, and 23 ministers of foreign affairs ministers of the European Union have effectively written to the European Commission to move on this issue ahead, but for the moment, France is blocking it. So we don't know how to go out of this. This is more than 2 years and now that we're spending a lot of energy to move this one. And we fear that the EU is going to be isolated and we will not be able to participate to the writing of the new standard on cross-border data flow, which will bring things even more complicated. But when we say, why don't we can have some language and then some exception, the what I'm calling the Ayatollah of the data privacy are actually saying, no, you cannot have an exception to a principle which is a human right. Therefore, not a single government should ever be asked to justify why it has a data protection legislation. So for us, it is not possible in Europe to say we are against data privacy. We're going to be killed on one day. So we have to build over this and try to find a solution, but it is not easy.
Thank you. Can you speak to the kinds of regulatory challenges that you're facing on a day-to-day basis as your companies are building out their range of services in the space?
Sure. So as I mentioned, we're really a data company. And some of the data that we have is actually not personally identifiable. So we don't know who you are. We just know where your card was used, how much it was used for at which merchant, and at what time. So in terms of privacy regulation, it not always affects us. But data localization is a huge issue for us. The free flow of data. There's sort of this, I call it the contagion effect in Southeast Asia, where countries are looking at what China has done and sort of mirroring what they're doing. And you know, restricting not only data flows, but also requiring us to process on soil. And for us to do that in the 210 countries we do business in would probably put us out of business. So that's a huge hurdle for us right now. Unfortunately, TPP was the first trade agreement that would have had commitments for electronic payment services. And now that we've withdrawn from TPP, we've seen in the last couple of months, you know, more countries take on protectionist measures to actually facilitate and put regulations out there that restrict not only data flows, but also our processing services on soil. So that's one of our biggest challenges. We also are seeing it creep up in the Middle East as well. So I would love to see TISA picked up again, because TISA was another great area where we saw some early good commitments on electronic payment services, and you know, on an agreement solely on services is, I think, missing today on today's trade agenda.
Yeah, I'd echo those comments, and you know, from a international sort of privacy and regulatory standpoint, Verizon does business in 150 countries around the world. So one of the big concerns that we have, and I would imagine most international companies have, or multinationals, is fragmentation. So when you start having regulations and policies that they're fragmented around the globe, it becomes all the more difficult and expensive to do business. And I know there's a lot of focus on the big companies, you know, the Googles, the Microsofts, perhaps the Verizons and the MasterCards, but you know, these rules that come into play also affect the small and medium businesses. Large businesses, at one level or another, have the resources to address these issues. It's the small and medium businesses that start to get caught up in these rules as well, because they have data that needs to move, and they have, you know, they will have to be subject to those same requirements as well. Most economies, I don't know this for sure, but I would guess that most economies are dominated by smaller and medium-sized businesses. So, you know, we can focus on the big guys, but let's not forget the smaller companies as well, and they get caught up in a lot of that discussion. So I think the localization point is a very important one to bear in mind. We also like TTIP, we like the fact that there was a more robust set of rules and regulations around data services, and we'd like to see that continue as well in future trade negotiations. So those are all big issues for us. One specific example, just maybe if I could, in the IoT space, one of the things that we see happening in various countries is an effort to regulate companies that are doing kind of tracking and tracing kinds of services, where you're for example, that I gave with the pharmaceuticals, and they will look at those types of services and apply the same regulations that they apply to mobile companies to those types of IoT services. It's like killing a fly with a sledgehammer. You know, at the end of the day, you know, these are companies that are trying to come up with new innovative ideas to help advance, you know, different aspects of manufacturing, agriculture, and so forth. To drop a set of rules on them because they happen to use the wireless networks and treat them like you would treat, you know, the major wireless provider in a particular country, that is the quickest way to slow or eliminate innovation in that particular sector.
I'd like, we're nearing the end, to open it up for questions from the audience. We have one right here. Do we have a microphone?
Hello, John Cook from the City UK. I've been very struck by the point that a number of speakers have made about the extent to which services now form part of merchandise trade in manufactured goods. And it just strikes me that here we are sitting in a jurisdiction where the trade policy at the moment seems to be based very much on trade in goods rather than services. Whether in fact we shouldn't be turning some of our arguments on their head and not saying services is important as part of goods, but saying goods are now important as part of services, because services is actually the majority component of United States international trade and European Union international trade. Shouldn't we be turning the argument on its head, and might that not make more impression on the authorities in countries that seem so interested in trade in goods at the moment?
Yeah, you sort of made that point.
I certainly agree with this. Indeed, for the only way that we can bring the manufacturers to focus on what is important for them into services is to make them understanding the issue, and therefore maybe because we have failed so far talking about servicification, maybe we should bring them and tell them this is about manufacturing, this is very important for you, and then you have to consider that not only looking at the tariff reduction and others, but also on the services part. So that is something that we will certainly take on board, yeah.
I completely agree with you. And I think that's what CSI has done a great job of doing, is kind of showing the example, yes. We should be talking about services. It is 80% of the GDP of the United States and probably most developed countries. But in order to get the attention, especially in this administration, you have to show them examples of how it enhances manufacturing, how it enhances agriculture. I spent last week we spent a day on the Hill kind of just talking exactly about that, and hoping, hoping to sink in and resonate that services is really important to enhancing manufacturing and agriculture.
Thank you. We have time for one more quick question. I think we had one down here.
Brett Fortin with Inside U.S. Trade. We've gone over some of the challenges that the service industry is facing, but given the focus of this administration on manufacturing, and jobs in manufacturing, what are the politically feasible solutions? Is it setting a precedent in the NAFTA negotiations? Is it picking up any plurilaterals that were left by the Obama administration? Or what is kind of seen as the next step?
Certainly from a political feasibility, Sarah just made the point about positioning and really understanding the importance of services to the manufacturing industries. But as far as vehicles forward, I don't know if the panel has any thoughts on that.
Well, I guess the language that has been agreed in TPP in the electronic commerce chapter is something that we are looking at. We would like to put it into the TISA, and I guess a way would be to bring it into NAFTA negotiation also. So that is probably a vehicle that there is no need to reinvent the wheel, and the three countries around the table were in TISA negotiation, were in TPP negotiation, have adopted that already. So maybe that is a way to put it effectively into the NAFTA.
Yeah, Pascal made the point that I was going to make as well. I think that's a great place to start. To bring that into NAFTA, to highlight the discussion, and hopefully to create some robust rules around data services, digital services.
Well, great. I want to thank you for those two very good questions, but please join me in thanking our four panelists.